from the APIs, the docs, the native SDKs we offer, and trying to make sure that like Stripe has a really smooth and pleasant experience for all of you guys when you integrate payments in your mobile apps or your websites. So quick show of hands to start tonight. Who has already heard or used the Stripe API before? A few of you have used Stripe? Cool. Who has never heard of Stripe before? Cool, okay. So the big news for us actually this week is that we are officially live in Singapore. So that was the big announcement we made. We're super excited to be here finally and be able to serve like all the great entrepreneurs and companies in Southeast Asia. Super happy, of course, to have Grab as one of our users here in the region. So tonight, what I suggest is that for those of you who have not heard about Stripe before, I will show you a few minutes of what kind of things we do to make payments really easy. Then we'll dive right in into like the API, see like how the core elements work together, native SDK for iOS, Apple Pay. And then if you guys want to follow along at the end, if you want to bring your laptop, feel free to just like open up Xcode and sign up for Stripe.com if you'd like. And yeah, and then we'll open up for Q&A. So let's get started. And by the way, at any point in time, if you guys have any questions, just feel free to interrupt me. Like, we're in a small group here, so we can make that interactive. I'm more than happy to take questions along the way. So quick reminder, why does even Stripe exist? Where does that even come from? Well, it's quite funny because when you think about the history of the internet and HTTP in particular, the foundational protocol of the web, we became quite familiar now over time about a bunch of ease specifications, like typically error codes and all these things that we've seen many, many times. And I'm sure all of you in this room have obviously seen 404 page not found online on the internet, or again, maybe 403, forbidden. How many of you guys have heard of 402 before? 402? Anyone?
Yeah, it's payment, right?
Yep. Yeah. It says payment required, but the best part is actually reserved for future use. That's all the spec says. And so for the longest time, for all of us developers in this room, when we wanted to make great services and mobile apps, all we had to deal with was extremely complex because payment was obviously something critical for the internet. From the early days, the creators of HTTP knew it would be like huge to figure this problem out, but it's never been fleshed out. That means for a long time we had to deal with like old-fashioned APIs and complex infrastructure to even accept payments. So that's exactly where Stripe came in. The goal being to make that very simple for all of the developers to integrate payments in their apps and services. So with that, we started with a very simple API to process payments. And so as you can see on screen, extremely easy with the minimum amount of information that you need, typically a currency, an amount, your API key identifying your request to the API, and a few parameters like the card number or description. So something extremely easy. That's how Stripe got started. Or if you want to see something that's more like a code, that's the equivalent in Ruby as opposed to like the curl request. So something very easy. The goal for Stripe has always been to get developers up and running in just a few minutes. Something extremely delightful to use. Because for us, we believe that payments shouldn't be a problem that's routine in finance. It should be a problem in code, like very simple to use and something very nice to play with. And the focus has always been not only to have great APIs, but also make it possible for our users to offer great experiences. So at Stripe, we try to build like all the tools and the APIs that all of you can use to then build your products and make them super nice for your end users. So typically, if you want to control the entire UI, the entire UX, you're always in control to do that, whether it's on the web or on mobile. Since the early days, every single payment method has always been something we wanted to simplify too. We were the first company to accept Bitcoin. From the early days, we had a partnership with Alipay to make sure that like Alipay could be like a payment method used even for the merchants in the US. And of course, we've been launch partners for Apple with Apple Pay, and same for Google and Android Pay. So always on the verge to like all the payment methods that are coming out there, so that you guys integrating payments in your services and your apps, you don't have to worry about these things, because Stripe is taking care of that for you. And in particular, because we're among iOS developers tonight, one of the things that we've done recently was to improve our native SDK for iOS, so that instead of having just the Apple Pay support, which we've had since the early days, we now have a lot of UI components that you can customize and reuse inside your app. So it's extremely nice because in some regions, obviously Apple Pay is not available, but even in Singapore, you're not quite sure whether all of your users are going to have Apple Pay set up on their phone. Sometimes they don't. And at least if they don't, now you have a super nice way to fall back on some beautiful user interfaces that you can customize. And we'll dive right in to see how they work. So with that, let's leave the slides and take a look at the Stripe API. Any questions so far? Cool. So I just wanted to walk you through these simple steps before we dive in, because I think it's quite important to understand how payment works at Stripe. So that's coming straight from our stripe.com documentation. Every time you want to accept a payment, whether it's on mobile or on the web, the one thing you don't want to deal with is PCI compliance. Like, the card number should never hit your servers, because you don't want to worry about all these things. So that's why with Stripe.js checkout for the web or the native SDKs, what Stripe has built for you is the ability to completely tokenize those things. So that means that the card numbers are going to be stored securely by Stripe, which is PCI compliant, so that you don't have to take that for you. We take the burden on us, and all you have to do is use tokens that are entirely easy to use. So first step here, let's assume we're on the web, we want to simply tokenize a card number. I'm just going to go ahead and click submit. Now we have tokenized those card details, and we can easily use that token. Usually the next step could be to just create a charge, but what we recommend is actually to create a customer object first. The cool thing about customers in general is that when you have a customer object, then at any point in the future, you can charge that customer again, subscribe this customer to a plan for recurring billing, or even refund your customers without asking all their card details ever again. So really cool to have those customer objects. So if I go ahead and copy this curl request here in my terminal, and if I run this code, I created my very first customer. Very easy to do by just passing the token we had created. And now that we have this customer object called Daniel, we can easily make a charge of 20 Singapore dollars here. And if I copy this curl request, make the first payment. And because we have stored these payment details, I can actually do a second request to the Stripe API to make a charge, but this time maybe 1,000 Singapore dollars. Those amounts are in cents. All right, so with that, second payment created, very easy. If I switch over to the Stripe dashboard here and refresh, so that's my Singaporean Stripe dashboard in test mode, so I can see exactly what's going on. So if I click on payments, you can now see the two charges I just made, one of 20, one of 1,000 Singapore dollars. Very easy to see what's going on. Next, I was just mentioning, for those of you in the room who are building some SaaS businesses, maybe you have the need for like recurring billing. And so if you have to build that logic yourself, it's extremely hard. Like imagine, okay, I want to bill this customer on a monthly basis for this plan, or maybe yearly. But also if the card is declined, I have to retry a couple times, and like, what am I going to do next? So all this logic is automatically built for you at Stripe. So all you have to do is first create some plans objects. So in that case, I'm going to create like a monthly plan of $9.99, and I'm going to call it Platinum Business. If I create this plan, then all I have to do is simply subscribe Daniel, the customer that we had, to this plan. And if that's the case, with just a simple comment like that, Daniel is going to be charged monthly $9.99. So all the logic is built for you. You don't have to worry about these things. So that was just the first quick tour of the Stripe API. And typically, if you want to create customers or charges on your backend, as opposed to using curl requests like I've done, that's extremely easy to do. We can just go back here, restart, create a new token again to securely store that card details. I'm going to copy the token. And if I go here, for instance, save the token. So typically, your mobile app or your web app would get that token, send it over to your backend, and then your backend would be here simply creating a customer from this token and charging the customer. So here, typically, let's say I want to create a customer object for Nikunj. Using that token, I want to charge him for 159 Singapore dollars, passing just the customer ID. So that's like very simple Node.js JavaScript code running inside a playground called Runkit. So Runkit is actually a cool tool if you want to use it to play around with JavaScript. It's now part of Stripe as well. So if I run this code, extremely simple, we now have a new customer object for Nikunj, and we have just made a new charge again. So if I go back to Stripe dashboard, over here, new charge. So once again, very easy. All right, so now that we have made this quick tour of the Stripe API and how the core elements work, let's dive into iOS and mobile more specifically. So from the very early days of Apple Pay, as I mentioned, we've always been a partner of Apple to support Apple Pay. But initially, it was pretty hard to build a fallback and native UIs. So I just wanted to show you, for instance, this app that I built when I was working for Twitter. For those of you who know Fabric and Crashlytics, I was previously on their team. And so I built this demo app using Stripe, actually, back in the day. It's like a very simple furniture store where you could just like go ahead, add some of your objects to your car that you want to buy. Let's say this nice pendant, interesting. Let's add this chair. So you get a few items, and if I hit finish and pay, very nice UI entirely based on Apple Pay, and that's triggered automatically by the Stripe SDK. So I can easily touch ID, process the payment, and here we go. The payment is now processed with Stripe. So very easy to do Apple Pay support. But the thing is, as I mentioned earlier, you're not quite sure whether like your customers and your users are going to have Apple Pay systematically on the device. So that's why we built this new SDK with now UI components as opposed to just the Apple Pay support. So I just wanted to show you, because we're here at Grab tonight, I just wanted to show you both some new functionality of the Stripe API and also those new UI components for the iOS SDK. So let's imagine we want to create a Grab or something similar. What would we need? Well, first we would need a way to potentially sign up drivers on the platform, right? And then we would need to have a very nice mobile app, and the Grab app for iOS is actually pretty good, so it's going to be hard to compete. But very nice mobile app so that people can request a ride, and of course you want to have a seamless way for them to pay for their ride. So they would hit pay, and then eventually you want to pay out the drivers. So we actually have at Stripe a product called Stripe Connect that enables marketplaces and platforms to do those things. So signing up drivers or sellers on the platform in white label fashion, controlling the entire UX, and then accepting payments easily that go straight to those sellers. So imagine, let's say I want to sign up Nikunj on the platform. All right, Nikunj at Stripe.com. I'm not going to reveal your real birthday, so let's do that. Working capital. What is the postcode of running capital?
I'm not sure.
You don't know?
1, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Yeah, that sounds like a good thing to do. Okay, and we probably need a vehicle, so I'm going to say that you're having a Volkswagen. And why did I skip your last name? I should not have skipped your last name. All right, so here we go. We have all the information we need, I think, to sign up Nikunj on the platform. So I'm just going to hit sign up. So behind the scene, what Stripe is doing here is creating a white label managed account on behalf of Nikunj. So that way, he doesn't even have to know that he has a Stripe account. It's completely white label. But this way, he will be able to receive payments from any of the riders on the platform. So right, so we're good to go. So if I fast forward a few hours or days later, we can see like the dashboard and how it works. That was a typical dashboard we made for Piruze at Stripe. So you can see very easily how the open API of Stripe lets you build those things. Cool, so now let's dive into mobile. I have here built this this app for riders, so the on the other side of the spectrum, and hopefully we'll be able to take some rides with this app. So a few things I wanted to point out. The first thing is, what you can do is extremely easy in terms of customization. So the first thing I've done here was setting up a little bit of config for the Stripe API so it knows exactly what to use. So first, my publishable key. So as you sign up for Stripe, you get a publishable key that you can embed in your clients, and a secret key that's more for your backend, something that you don't even want to share in your final product. In that case, I wanted to use Apple Pay, so I just put my Apple Pay merchant identifier. That's my domain, so I put merchant in front of it, company name writer, and you can also pass to that config a bunch of additional fields if you want to. So let's say you want to have like the zip code for your users, you can pass that along as well. And the other thing that you can customize, as I mentioned, is the entire UI. So typically, we'll let you customize the background, foreground, the font, and all these things. So we'll see how it looks like in a few seconds, so let's leave it there. And if I compile this app with just like the Stripe SDK all set here, just gonna see now what's gonna happen. All right, so we have a simple map here. We have the ability to pick a destination, and we have Apple Pay automatically supported. So I've written literally no code to have Apple Pay running in this app. So if I switch over to the write request, let's take a look at how this thing actually works to display those things. There's four methods that we have as part of what we call the Stripe Payment Context Delegate. So the Stripe Payment Context is this new object that we have introduced, so you can actually have those UIs working very nicely in your app. So let's go through this delegate. It's very easy to implement. The first thing we'll need is what we call the callback for Payment Context Did Change. So that means you have ready to update the user interface because we've been able to fetch the customer information, and so you can display exactly what the latest is. So in my case, Apple Pay was the default method, so I can just display Apple Pay here. There's another method as part of the delegate, which is did fail to load with error. This one is actually really rare. It's only going to be used typically if like internet is down or if the connection is pretty bad, because that means we have not been able to fetch the customer details from the Stripe backend. Then the two interesting pieces are coming. The first is did create payment result. So this one actually means that we've been successfully able to tokenize the card details from the UI. And now, using that payment result, you're ready to send that to your backend to actually make a charge for real, make a payment for this customer. So you're going to just pass along the result, the amount that you want to charge, the currency, so typically Singapore dollars here, and the completion block. And finally, just after this method is called, you will have access to did finish with and passing a status. So that means we just completed the payment entirely, so now you can just update the UI accordingly. So typically if it's Apple Pay, all the UIs of Apple Pay have been dismissed, or if it's your custom UIs and so on, everything has been dismissed and you're ready to retry or cancel, or like at least update the UI for the end customer saying the payment has been completed. Cool. So now, if I build this app on my phone instead of the simulator, we'll be able to play around a bit more, because I, like on purpose, I disabled Apple Pay on this phone so that we can actually see what the interface looks like when there's absolutely no Apple Pay involved on the device. I'll switch over to my phone, and the app should be running in a second. There we go. Cool. So here we are. Let's pick a destination here to go somewhere. I'm gonna say airport. Cool. So now the interesting piece is this. So we've been able to compute like a very simple, you know, ETA, an estimate for the ride. It's gonna be 45 Singapore dollar. And if I tap on payment, that's the native flow that we provide as part of the SDK. So you don't have to rebuild all these interfaces yourself now. You can simply customize their colors and pass along the information you want. So typically here I'm gonna put in my email. I'm gonna tap my card number. As you can see, I have a very simple Visa card number, very easy to remember. And I can put a zip code, because we had requested to have this extra billing address info as part of the config. So if I hit done, perfect. So as you can see, we just called the method that tokenized the card. It saved that over to the backend in the customer object that we have. So now my card is registered here, and I've been able to refresh the UI. If I kill this app entirely, and if I start the app again, now my customer object has been saved on Stripe's backend, so now my card will be automatically available for me here. So it's super cool. Only once the user has to set up their card, and it's automatically saved. So now I just have to type airport again because we've been killing this thing. Apple Pay. Okay, Apple Pay is not here, perfect. Okay, so we're gonna go to the airport using this Visa 4242 card, and it's gonna be $45. So if I hit request right now, we just match with the driver. In that case, we match with Pirouzé, so that's awesome. And now, if we switch over to the Stripe dashboard, there's something very interesting to see here. First, we have, as we've seen earlier, the charge that has been powered here. I also was able to pass my statement descriptor. So that means if you're building an app like Grab or any other kind of, you know, mobile app, obviously you don't want to have Stripe showing up on the bank statements of your customers because they're not aware of Stripe. So you can easily pass along your details. And the two extra pieces of information that are really nice about this charge, and that goes with like Stripe Connect that I was mentioning earlier, this charge of $45 has actually two interesting properties. The first one is the collected fee. So as the platform builder, you can decide how much of every ride or how much of every transaction you want to take for you to make revenue on your platform. So in that case, out of $45, I actually wanted to have 10% for myself as the builder of this app. And the second thing is this destination account. Usually when you make a charge on the Stripe API, typically you don't put any destination because the money goes to your account. But in that case, by passing along Pirouzé's account that we signed up, we know that the money is gonna go straight to her. So the amount of the transaction minus the cut you wanted to take, and that goes straight to your managed account. So super, super easy to do. And if we take a look at the backend for that, what would it look like to actually have that implemented, let's say in JavaScript in Node.js? Well, first you would have to create a managed account. Very easy to do, just a few parameters. So in that case, we can pass, let's say, the country, an email address, and potentially any other pieces of information you want, like first name, last name. And you can always decide to pass this kind of information upfront or later on in the process, like all these accounts can be updated anytime. And making a payment is exactly the same, except you will have those two extra parameters that I described earlier. The first one being the destination. So in that case, we're assuming that we're gonna do a $30 charge for this customer that goes straight to driver account. And the application fee being once again like 10% of the transaction, but that can be the value that you want. Any questions on the Stripe API or maybe on the Stripe SDK and the UI components that you've seen? Yeah?
Just one question. If you use Apple Pay, right?
Yeah.
The token you get is for one-time usage, right?
So the cool thing about Apple Pay and the rest of the payment method is that you don't have to worry about those things on your backend. Apple Pay is a bit specific because when you use Apple Pay, you decrypt the card on the fly from the device. And so it's actually fine to have a one-time token because you just decrypt on the fly and put your fingerprint. Mm-hmm. But yes, it's a one-time use token.
So which means that I cannot store the token and reuse for future charges, right?
I don't believe so, yeah. Because I think you don't have... At Stripe, I don't think we see the card number in that case. We just use a token, yeah. We make a charge out of that token. Because we have a simple one-to-one relationship between like Apple Pay tokens and Stripe tokens, like they're easily chargeable for us. But yeah, so if your user of your app uses Apple Pay and has no other mention, I think they will use their fingerprint and Touch ID every time.
So how does it work for recurring payments? So in that case, you cannot use Apple Pay for recurring payments?
It's a good question.
You can. So But with Apple Pay, you can do recurring payments only if they are true recurring payments. Mm-hmm. And the way Apple describes true recurring payments is that if it's truly a subscription service.
Right.
So what you can do is you can charge an Apple Pay token every month or every day or every 2 weeks for the same amount. You can like have the amount go up and down a little, but it should usually be the same amount.
Yeah, it would but not probably be as fancy as what we like make possible with Stripe, like the coupons and discount and then like charging right. plans and also, and so on.
That's right. What you cannot do with Apple Pay tokens is save them and charge them for different amounts each time.
Yeah.
So if you're a Grab and you're taking rides, those are recurring, you're like taking payments again and again, but that does not count as recurring payments. That is just
a one-time
payment. Yeah. So you have to request a payment each time and then do it. But in the back end, the good thing about Stripe is that you still get you can use any payment method with the same back end. Like Apple Pay gives you a Stripe token, Android Pay gives you a Stripe token, Alipay gives you a Stripe token, everything gives you a Stripe token, and all of that can be used with the same back end at Stripe. So you just write one back end, and all of the different UI components have different payment methods that talk to that same back end.
Yeah.
So it's pretty neat.
So typically here in that code example for Node.js, assuming your backend would be Node, like obviously the token here would not be outcoded, but it would be something along the lines of like request.body.stripe.token potentially, like if you're using Express, for instance. And in that case, you would get a token from your client, and you don't have to worry about like, oh, is it Apple Pay? Was it Android Pay? Was it like a card? Like it's exactly the same for you. So it's cool because from the backend perspective, you accept all payment method without like worrying about where the token comes from. And from the mobile perspective, you actually don't have to worry about like building the UI or even like, oh, did this user use Apple Pay or was it actually a card? So it's gonna be exactly the same on both sides. So extremely easy to use. And the other thing I was mentioning, we can actually go back to that. If we switch over to Xcode again and go back to the app delegate, you have the ability here on Stripe to set up all the colors and the look and feel for the SDK. So depending on your color scheme, typically Grab would probably be around like the green, and in the US we have like, let's say, Instacart, they're more like on the orange side of things. So it's extremely easy to like customize the look and feel and make it so all these payments view controllers are part of your user experience and not like very foreign with different colors. We actually have like a daily Stripe documentation now for iOS. So of course I did not mention that earlier, but you can install the Stripe SDK from your favorite package manager, whether it's CocoaPod or Carthage or Fabric even. We probably don't recommend to use like dynamic framework or static framework yourself for the sake of updating, but they're all available as well. So that's the app delegate with the publishable key, as I mentioned earlier, and then the config, the API, and then finally, if we scroll down the things we've seen here, at the end you have the ability to customize all this look and feel, so you can pass like all these parameters and make sure that this UI looks really good. And also, it works with any flow, so if you have like a navigation controller, you can push. And if you have more something like I had, but like I want to have a model view controller, you can easily present. So extremely easy to do and accept payments on mobile. Right. The other thing, is there any questions other questions on Apple Pay natively or UI components for iOS or Stripe in general? Anything on your mind? The other thing I wanted to mention, I'm sure a lot of you guys have followed this news recently, Apple Pay is launching on the web, has launched on the web. So it's now available as part of iOS 10, and it's going to be very soon available in macOS Sierra, whenever they launch. I think it's coming in a few days. Or it might have come already. Was it yesterday? That was this week, actually. So yes, macOS Sierra is now out. So we have Apple Pay for the web on Safari, mobile, and desktop. And once again, like at Stripe, we made sure that we have all the documentation and all the processes in place to make that super easy. So on the documentation side, it's actually quite interesting because how many of you guys have looked at the Apple Pay for the web docs? A few of you? So we actually try to simplify that as much as we possibly could. So typically what we've done is extending Stripe.js. So Stripe.js is our JavaScript library. And what we did was making sure that it's completely extended and ready for Apple Pay. So in that case, assuming you have a website that includes Stripe.js, now all you have to do after setting up your publishable key for Stripe once again is take a look at this new object that we made inside Stripe, so stripe.applepay, and you can now check the availability of Apple Pay. That's an asynchronous function, and then you will know whether it's available or not, and if you can present this new button that Apple can provide to you. And then with that, you can easily create the Apple Pay session. So the Apple Pay session will let you create like the sheet for Apple Pay with like all the details of like the currency and the country, the description of what you wanna have in this session, and then easily using that token, once you build up the session, you can actually send that to your backend as well to process the payments. So very similar process between Apple Pay for the web and native, of course, but in both cases we make sure that we can offer the best experience for you guys to limit the number of line of codes you have to do. So on one side, natively on the SDK, it's available out of the box, and if you're using the CocoaPods garbage to get this SDK in your app, or on your website, just using Stripe.js gets you up and running with just those few lines of code to add Apple Pay. So I'm not running Sierra on this device yet, but if we quit this app in the simulator that is running here on iOS 10, so typically that's the stripe.com/Apple Pay page. So if you want to take a look on your phone, for instance, you can now go over to Safari in iOS 10, and if you tap on Try It Now, that brings up immediately the Apple Pay sheet to make a payment. Exactly the same as native, so you can of course like switch over to your cards and so on, and then just pay with Touch ID, in that case a passcode, and you're good to go. So just a few lines of JavaScript in your mobile sites, and you're good to go to accept Apple Pay using Stripe.js. So that's pretty exciting too. I think we're just at the beginning of simplifying payments also on the web and not only natively. And I think it's very powerful because when you look at the time we all spend on mobile, we spend like most of our time like on websites and mobile apps, but when you look at conversion rates for mobile, they're actually extremely bad for websites, because you know, if you find out a nice product you want to buy, and if you're on a Safari on iOS, for instance, then you have to go through all these steps to like put in all your card details and addresses and so on with like your tiny keyboard, and sometimes you just give up. As opposed to now with Apple Pay for the web, you set up your wallet once on iOS, and now any website on Safari can let you pay in just one tap and Touch ID. So very exciting stuff. Any questions maybe on Apple Pay for the web? Have you guys used Apple Pay for the web already? If you have not, I really encourage you to go to stripe.com/Apple Pay from your phone or from macOS Sierra in Safari. So using this page, you can just like click to this Try It Now button, and we'll actually not make a charge for real, but you can actually see the flow and how it looks like on Safari. So pretty nice. Cool. The last thing I wanted to mention is that the Stripe iOS SDK that I showed you is also open source on GitHub. So if you go to github.com/stripe-ios, let me zoom in a little bit for you guys. So that SDK is all open source. So our engineers are developing in the open here, and we actually have a couple example apps inside this project. So if you guys want to sign up for stripe.com, you will get in just a few seconds, you will get your publishable key and secret key. And then if you download, for instance, this example app from this repository, you'll be able to just place your publishable key, and then you will be good to go. The other project that we've also been putting up on GitHub to simplify how you get started with Apple Pay and Stripe payments on iOS is this project called example-ios-backend that we have. So same, it's under the Stripe organization on GitHub. And the cool thing with this backend is that we have it deployed to Heroku. So if you're just trying to get started with iOS on the SDK side, you want to have something that really works in a few minutes, but you don't want to worry about like building a backend yet that accepts payments and so on, you can actually easily click on deploy to Heroku here, which I'm going to do, and then you will be able to just like make your app talk to this backend, and you'll be good to go. So in that case, if I put an app name here, let's say Stripe Singapore, there we go, it's available. And if I go to my account settings, API keys, we want my secret key, of course, so take my secret key, deploy the backend, and while the backend is deploying, I can actually show you this other example app that we have in the Stripe workspace. There we go. So if I go over here in the app delegate, so here I can put my publishable key. There's a good one already. And here we can have Stripe-Singapore was the name. Yes. So if I put here Stripe-Singapore.geroku, and if I build this app on my simulator, I'm actually good to go with just those two lines of code. So see, like, just sign up for Stripe.com, you bring your publishable key in the iOS app, then you deploy your backend easily to Heroku or Google Cloud or AWS, or what you prefer, bring this URL here, and then this app is good to go. So it's just an app where you can buy some products based on the emoji. And once again, so that's the same flow as the one you've seen earlier, except this time, as opposed to presenting, I'm just like pushing inside the navigation controller. So yeah, if you guys want to get started with Stripe, I think that's a good way to start. You can just go check out our project on GitHub, or just go straight to our Stripe docs. Extremely easy to get started, because essentially you get your favorite way to get the Stripe SDK, whether it's CocoaPod or Carthage, and in just a few seconds, you're good to go. So, really easy to do. Any questions on any products that you've seen? Apple Pay, whether it's native or for the web? I guess the last thing I should mention to you is the backend piece that I was just deploying. So the backend piece that I was just deploying is actually a convenience that talks to Stripe SDK. So typically, as you've seen during the flow, when I am here like changing my card details, what we want is three things. The ability to fetch a customer, for instance. Like, so every time I'm loading this app, I can fetch my customer. The ability to add a source to a customer or remove sources from customers. So these kind of functionalities are just a few wrappers you have to make on the Stripe API. And so to make that even faster for you guys to do, that's why we open source the Ruby backend. But we're planning to have like many more languages for the examples. But yeah, so this way your SDK is up and running without worrying. Cool. Well, thank you so much. If you have any questions, I'm happy to stick around and get to meet you and talk about all the great apps you're building. So thank you so much again for coming. And let us know if we can help further. I can't wait to see what you build with Stripe. Thank you.